timing, and then I'll then take your questions. The timing for students who are studying in the summer is my favorite way to do ACT prep or SAT prep. You do a lot of your study before school gets started. Now, any of your kids who haven't started studying yet, they still have time, because 2 weeks in August, if you're working with a tutor 5 days a week, you can get all of the stuff in. There's 20 hours. If you do your 2 hours a day for 10 days, you're at the 20. 2.5 hour sessions that can allow you to do this in just 8 days, or maybe you get 25 hours in. It is doable. And the reason why I don't need to break it up like I do in the academic year is, your kids who might only have a part-time job, say 20 hours a week, and otherwise are studying for the SAT becomes their part-time job. That's the other part-time job. So now they're combined to 40 hours a week. It's still less than school. School, you know, they're at it 60 hours a week. You work less than they do. So you end up actually buying yourself more time to study if you have even 3 weeks free in the summer, compared to having 3 months where all you can do is typically one night a week or one afternoon on a weekend during the school year. So once school gets heavy, I don't encourage SAT more than once a week. Sometimes kids will do twice, but usually once a week is it, and now you're looking at a 3 or 4 month progression to get those 25, 30, 35 hours in. That's why summer is so valuable. Now, if you missed it and you can't do summer, your kid's still away, won't be back until about when school starts. The break in the winter used to be a very good time to study for the January SAT. Kids who, especially if they were private school, they sometimes had 3 weeks off. Public schools still give you 2 weeks off. You can get a lot accomplished over the December break. When there was a January SAT, that was a very good time to do it. But as of 2018, there is no January SAT. So winter break study needs to get followed up during the next 2 months. You can still crank with a tutor over 2 straight weeks, Christmas week, New Year's week, but then use the rest of January and all of February to ramp up to the March test with once a week refresh, be keeping your brain going to lead up the test. Some kids will do no vacation study. They'll be once a week, they'll spend maybe 10 straight weeks, and they could start in September and get ready for the December test. Or they could start in November and get ready for the March test. So there's lots of timing opportunities. I don't want any SAT prep to take away from school to get good grades, or to take away from extracurricular activities that are fun, productive, get you a credential, school sports, that's really the other one. So I really try to get kids doing the study, whether it's ACT or SAT, when they have the most time. Now, some parents say, but my kid's not ready yet. He's only had sophomore year learning. How could he possibly start the SAT at the beginning of his junior year? Answer, because the SAT is not testing stuff that is going to be acquired in the junior year. The SAT verbal is testing reading, which are skills that you've acquired for the last 9 years. The SAT grammar is testing skills that are usually coming out of 5th, 6th, 7th grade, and hopefully you're still using them come 10th and 11th grade. The math has some kids that don't have all the math on the SAT by 10th grade. Most do, because there is no use of the quadratic formula on the SAT. There's very minimal use of trigonometry, and those two things we can teach really easy anyway. I shouldn't have said no use of the quadratic formula. It could come up once or twice. Trigonometry, two, maybe three times on the SAT. I'm not saying to miss those questions. I want those kids getting all five of those questions right. We can teach that. And you don't have to be plodding through junior year math where you may or may not get those skills. And in very few schools, even if they're teaching those skills, they don't teach it to the test. They don't hone in on what the SAT is testing. That's my big indictment of schools. But that's why firms like ours, Ivy Bound, exist, because we shore up where schools are either intentionally or unintentionally leaving kids hanging. So you do not need to wait until the end of the junior year to get what you need skill-wise to master the SAT or the ACT. There is no calculus on either test. There is only a few high-level questions on the ACT and none on the SAT. So kids after sophomore year should feel ready. A lot of kids are ready after freshman year. They're not pushed to do it as sophomores, but I encourage it. If they're calling up on the phone and my office hears, my student is a very ambitious rising sophomore, can he take your course? The answer is yes. And then I would have him test as a sophomore. Makes sense. Because again, the colleges, they don't care how many times you take the test. They care about seeing one good score, or even that combination, the super scoring, two good scores, one on math, one on verbal, that they combine. A few colleges do the super scoring on the ACT as well. Not as many, it's about 45% of colleges that actually they can see two or three different ACTs. And since the ACT has four sections, they may cherry pick the best math, the best English, the best science, the best reading, and give the student the best of that. Only about 45% of the colleges do that, but a 95% of the colleges super score the SAT. All right, let me open up to your questions. Anything goes at this point, and let me